little book. And we got some handouts coming.
We do. There was only 12 copies, so we have to share.
That's fine. But if you are one who doesn't take a lot of notes, allow somebody who does your copy. So, next time, we will be looking at the temple and the two witnesses. That's chapter 11. So you can share with somebody.
Yeah, I don't. I mean, who needs one?
She's got the she's got the note maker. She lives with the note maker. Bueller.
Bueller.
So, chapter 11 is a very interesting chapter. There's a lot of really neat stuff there when you start to peel the skin off of it. Stuff that back in 95 AD they probably had no concept of. But we'll get into a little bit deeper idea of what is being spoken about the temple and the two witnesses. Knowing that there's a lot of speculation and we're not going to get bogged down. Come next week prepared to talk about the temple, but more importantly about the two witnesses. And so read Revelation 11 for next week. So, first trumpet. Just a little review. First trumpet is aimed at the earth. Burns up a third of the trees and the grass. The second trumpet is aimed at the sea. A third of the fish and the ships are destroyed. That was second trumpet. The third trumpet is aimed at the waters, the fresh waters. And that's where a third part of the freshwater systems die. And that's where we see the star called Wormwood. What was the Ukrainian name for Wormwood?
Chernobyl.
Chernobyl. Chernobyl. I'll get it out. Which is kind of ironic, I believe, given what radiation does. Four trumpets aimed at the sun, moon, and the stars. And as we discussed, a third of the sky is darkened. And that is likely a result of the previous three trumpets. It could be supernatural darkening, but more likely it's a result of all the fires and the debris and the gases that are released from these first three judgments, these impacts where you start to see some sort of a nuclear winter. And we need to keep in mind that the when you dim the sun, what happens? Okay, why?
It needs light for photosynthesis.
But whatever, what else happens?
Temperature
drops. That's the reason why when we get Arctic fronts or we get Canadian fronts like we had come through on Saturday morning, that's the reason why it happens, because there's not a whole lot of sunlight up there. And so there's no incoming solar radiation hitting buildings and trees and grass and fields and mountains and converting into long-wave radiation, which is what gives off heat. The Earth absorbs short-wave and it releases long-wave. That's a little scientific tidbit. But that's why you feel the warmth, is the long-wave radiation that's being emitted. Well, when you don't have that, you don't get warmth. So, a little side trip into science. Thank you, Mr. Schultz.
Satan knew exactly when God spoke that word to him in Genesis 3. He knew exactly who God was sending. Because see, he had existed with him for a very long time. And his first thing that Satan remembers upon his creation is seeing Jesus Christ. Because who is the creator of all things? Jesus, the angel of the Lord. He's the creator of it all. And so when Satan opened his eyes for the first time with conscious thought, there's Jesus. So he knew who was coming. So that was the attempt. So we have these angels that are chained. Now for a bonus, come on in. For a bonus question, what hell, what's the name of the hell in which the fallen angels are currently chained because they left their first estate? That's what Peter says. What is the name of the hell? Not Gehenna.
Tartarus.
Boom! That's a double. I'm very proud that my wife got it. Tartarus. Not to be confused with tartar sauce. It's Tartarus. That is the hell in which they are currently chained. Tartarus. Now, so we have three hells. What's the first one's name? No, that's the second.
Three hells.
What's the first one? Sheol or Hades. Tartarus and
Gehenna.
All right. Who's in Gehenna right now?
Gehenna.
Who's in Gehenna right now? Nobody. It's empty. It's a lake of fire. Right. It's empty. Who ends up in Gehenna? And after the great white throne? All the lost. They're all going to be there. Having fun for eternity together.
Or the lack of.
And then Hades will be empty. So, 100,000 years from now, assuming the Lord has come by then, I would hope, what you would see if you were to go to Hades is two compartments. Right now, there's two compartments. One of which is empty. That's paradise. That's Abraham's bosom. That's where Jesus went to preach to the souls that are in prison. On the other side is the boat of the dead. That's where we see in Luke 16, the rich man. Lazarus is on one side, rich man's on the other. Well, guess who's the rich man? Where the rich man? He's still there. He's still there. But one day he's getting transferred to Gehenna.
Is the bottomless pit in the middle? Is the bottomless pit in the middle?
It could be.
That's what I've seen.
It could be. That could be where the bottomless pit is. Or it could be where Tartarus is. We don't know. Exactly right, Roman. That's exactly right. So, whoever these demonic locusts are, I believe they're probably the angels that are missing in action after Genesis 6. Because we know we have demons running around now. Okay? But we have angels that are bound for a time. I believe this is when they're loose. And if you're a demon and you have been bound in chains and tormented and not even be able to be loose and wreak havoc like you want to for thousands of years, what's your attitude? How's your attitude?
Upset.
Probably pretty bad and upset. Okay? Even worse than a regular demon. It's like, it's time for some payback. Brother.
You said they were
consumes to destruction, to Abaddon. It goes somewhere, and it goes to where Abaddon is. And then Psalm 88:11, shall thy loving kindness be declared in the grave, or thy faithfulness in destruction? This is Abaddon. So we get an idea of what and who Abaddon is. He is the epitome of destruction. And Proverbs 15:11, hell and destruction are before the Lord. How much more are the hearts of the children of men? So, if these bad things have to bow, how much more do you? Is what the proverb is saying. Proverbs 27:20, hell and destruction are never full, so the eyes of men are never satisfied. So, they're never full. In other words, there's room for more. You know, don't think that, well, you know what, I'm good enough. I'm not going there because there's a lot more people that need. No, 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 they got room. There's a vacancy sign out. So, the results of this are they're allowed these demon locusts, whatever they are, whatever shape they are, whatever form they come in, they're allowed to torment people who do not have the seal of God for 5 months. Now, this is harkening back to Revelation 7, where we see, do not harm the earth or the sea or the trees until we have sealed the servants of our God on their foreheads. But we also have some other scriptures. I don't believe that that Christians who have come to Christ through the witness of the 144,000 are going to be tormented by these guys, because they may not have the seal of the apostleship of these 144,000. The world was turned upside down by 12 apostles. And actually more, because Barnabas was an apostle. You know, we have some other apostles. But the 12, what we would call the 12 apostles. Imagine what happens with 144,000. That's incredible. So, we read in Ephesians 4:30, this is one of my favorite scriptures. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit, whereby which you are sealed unto the day of redemption. When I sin, brothers and sisters, my first act of contrition is confession of the sin, and then apology for grieving the Holy Spirit. Father, I am so sorry. I have grieved your Holy Spirit. Please, do not let him depart from me.
Good grief. Because I am son-son or son-son, and she has
So these demon locusts are after people who do not have the seal of God. They know they're off limits. Hey, what does that tell you about demons? That even demons are
limited.
Limited. They are subject to the authority of Almighty God. Never forget that. They're not subject to your authority. They're subject to God's authority. And I've shared the story about me getting up and with a demon one time and ending up in the hospital within 20 minutes. True story. And I'll share that later. But true story. Within in the emergency room, within 30 minutes of raising up my hand in a bolsterous way, in a good intentions against the Prince of Chad, because I was praying for some missionaries. I got an email from the International Missionary Board, and I got on my knees at a hotel room in San Antonio and came against the Prince of Chad, the chief demon. I said, "I rebuke you in the name of the Lord." And I got a little mouthy. I got not in the flesh, even though a good Pentecostal charismatic would have thought I was wrong. Within 30 minutes, I was in an ambulance. But my doctor, Jude verse 9. But unbeknownst to me, a couple hours before, my daughter had told Vanessa in the aisle of Walmart, "We've got to pray for Daddy," and stopped, and they prayed for me right there, having no idea, and she recorded it. And I played it for the ambulance drivers as I'm hooked up and headed to the hospital. And I'm feeling better. And she says, "Oh, my Lord, that explains this." And she sent it to me, and I played for it. And the ambulance people were like, "Wow. God protects." He spoke to my 5-year-old girl.
Any railing accusation.
That's right.
He said, "The Lord rebuked you."
The Lord rebuked you. And I got a little mouthy.
No, he didn't say, "I rebuked you."
That's right.
He said,
"The Lord rebuked you." So, death. I find this so interesting that death will not be found. They're going to try. But what does that tell you about God? He's the one that writes in the appointment book.
Yeah.
Not you. He's the one.
You don't think that has nothing to do with the Lord?
It could. Even more smoke and darkness, which is, I believe, is a continuation and an increase of the darkness in the fourth trumpet. So there's even more. So, sixth trumpet, real quick. Sixth angel blew the trumpet, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar before God. Y'all remember when you read in Chronicles and in Kings, when Joab was about to get killed, because he had been a naughty boy, what did he do? He went and laid his hands on what? It's the Old Testament trivia time. That's why the Word of God is so important. Joab laid his hands on the horn of the altar, the horns of the altar, because there was a superstition that, well, as long as I'm grabbing this, you can't kill me. Well, all they did was just drag him off of that thing and kill him outside. And I think it was Athaliah who married, was it Josiah? It was not Hezekiah. I can't remember who Athaliah married. But she was the daughter of Ahab and Jezebel, and she married to the king of Judah. And then when the king of Judah died, she took over. Well, that's what she did too. She went and laid her hands on the horns of the altar, and they just yanked her off that thing and slew her in the doorway. So, this is that altar. Release the four angels bound at the river Euphrates. And what we see happens here is a 200 million man army. And this army has stopped at the Euphrates River. Something is keeping them there. Now, I believe that this is the kings of the east. We read that later. Make way for the kings of the east. And I don't believe it's just China. I believe it's probably a Indochina confederation, if you will, that are making their way for, and they're basically being led to the Battle of Armageddon. They're marching towards Armageddon in that last campaign. Because we need to remember that not everyone is going to be pleased with the Antichrist's rule. There's going to be some rebellion. We see that in Daniel chapter 11, that the king of the south will rise up against the king. Okay? So, not everyone's going to be pleased with old Antichrist. And what we see is that a third of mankind. this time, however far this is, 3 billion people are dead. That's a lot of debt. That's a lot of productivity lost. That is a lot of
stink.
Go ahead, Rudy.
A lot of stink.
A lot of stink, yeah. I mean, man, you can't bury 3 billion people, especially when they're dying in waves like that. You know, if you read stories from the Black Death, from the middle, follow them up, burn them, but the stench, you hear some of the testimonies, was just unbelievable. So, this is an assault, really, too, on the senses of man. Not just on your mental senses, your spiritual senses, but your physical senses as well. Okay? So there's hunger. Remember, hey, they're not going to hunger anymore or thirst anymore, which means that they're hungry and thirsty when they're alive. So that judgment is on all. So they're killed by three methods from this army. They smoke and fire and sulfur coming from their mouths. So this is where I think we get into the machinery of warfare. So you got smoke, fire, and sulfur. Now, one of the key ingredients of gunpowder is sulfur. Alright. So, they kill a third of mankind. The rest, or half of the first population, this is so interesting. They refuse to repent. Now, there's a sense that they know who the judgment's from. We see that, because in Revelation 6, they're crying out. The wrath of the Lamb has come. Save us from this guy. Now, they may be crying out to Antichrist to save them from God. I don't know. But there's an awareness of this is supernatural. This is not natural. This isn't just bad luck. This is something else. Their body is to be used by you. So they will not I said, you didn't just wait till tomorrow, brother. He goes, no, I got to know now. I've been reading. I got to know now. So I appreciated the hunger. I really do. Vanessa can tell you, after being 18 years married to me, that nothing really gets me going more than when people ask me questions about the Bible and I get to share. I love that. I really do. I always have. That's why if it's 2 o'clock in the morning and you call me because you've got a real question about the Bible, forgive my first 30 seconds with you and give me time to wake up. But
what are you doing calling me at 2 in the morning, Tommy?
But what are you doing? Give me time to wake up, and then I will be more than glad to share whatever I can with you. So I saw another mighty angel coming down from heaven, wrapped in a cloud with a rainbow over his head. His face was like the sun. His legs were filled with fire. He had a little scroll, a Biblionia, Bible. He had a little Bible. He set his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land, showing his sovereignty over all of it. And he called out with a loud voice. Now, we're going to do a little quick review here. Remember, there's 2 words in Greek for another. 2 words. One was allos, which means another of a different type, and one was heteros, which means another of the same type. And in the previous verses in Revelation where we had another angel, it was always heteros. In other words, it's the same type of angel as the one mentioned before. It's just a different one. Well, now the word allos is used, which means it's another of a different type. So this is not like the previous ones. The previous mighty angel mentioned was the one who was saying in Revelation 5:2, who's worthy to open the seal? That was the previous mighty angel. And the word used there was heteros, another mighty angel. So, in other words, this is different. This mighty angel has to be different from this one because the word allos is used. So, this mighty angel is Jesus Christ. Now, to get that, all you got to do is go look at the description in Revelation 1. Okay? But also in Revelation 4:3, he who sat there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian. Around the throne was a rainbow. It had the appearance of an emerald. Now, we just see in this mighty angel, what did he have around his head?
A rainbow.
Ezekiel 1:28 says, like the appearance of the bow that was in the cloud on the day of rain, so was the appearance of the brightness all around, which was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord. Oh, that should be Ezekiel. So the little scroll. Now, one thing that I'm going to ask the Lord when I get to heaven is, why did you do this? This has bugged me forever. The 7 thunders speak. And I was about to write it down and say, no, don't write. Why would you? Don't even tell me that they spoke. I don't know. You know, I know God had a reason, but that's one of the ones I don't know why he would do that to me. Because I'm just, you know, tell me what's, you have no idea, guys, really, how many times I've prayed for it. Tell me what 7 thunders are. And you know what the answer is? If I didn't let John write it, I ain't going to tell you.
Yeah, I think it's
move on.
Anything to do with the, what was the other guy's called? Sons of Thunder?
I don't know. I'm not going to speculate. And believe me, I've spent hours upon hours of speculating. I've sat down one time and tried to figure it out.
It made yourself miserable.
I certainly did.
That's probably why you lost all
your hair. That could be it. That was about the time.
Was it me?
That didn't come from me.
So the scroll reveals the mystery of God will be fulfilled. It's sweet to the taste, but bitter to the stomach. And we need to know because there's joy in the word of the Lord. But the results of speaking it bring about sorrowful consequences. John loves God's word, but it's tough to speak it sometimes. It is tough to speak damnation in people's lives. Okay? But that's also what a sign of true love is. We're not going to go through all of this. That's what the notes are for. And if you don't have a note sheet, then guess what? Go to the website. When you get your email, go to the website. It'll be here. But these are where all the mysteries